Good morning. It gives me a great pleasure to introduce our colleague, Dr. Padma Satish. Dr. Padma studied at IIT Madras. She did her master's in chemistry. And after 1 year of post-MSc in biosciences at Saha Institute of Nuclear Physics in Kolkata, she did her PhD in bioorganic chemistry from University of Cambridge, UK in 1999. After that, she worked for a year at Max Planck Institute of Experimental Medicine, Göttingen in Germany, as a research scientist, and later in the chemistry department of IIT Bombay. Since 1996, she has been working in the office of Dean R&D of IIT Bombay, Industrial Research and Consultancy Center, as a technical officer and as chief technical officer, and as a chief technical officer since 2005. You may not be knowing, IRCC or Industrial Research and Consultancy Center is a nodal unit for coordinating all research and development activities at IIT Bombay. Her broad functions encompass the complete intellectual property management, including protection, deployment, licensing, contracts, agreements related to work, IP policy activities, new initiatives, liaison with industry and sponsored research. And facilitation processes towards promotion of R&D of IIT Bombay. She has been also involved in organizing IP-related seminars and workshops and has given IP-related talks at national level and in different workshops. Held student orientation programs and also for industry personnel. So with this brief introduction, I would hand over to Dr. Padma Satish. She has very vast experience in dealing with industrial consultancy projects and IP issues related to that. Dr. Padma Satish.
Very good morning to all of you. I hope I will be, yes, I will try my best to share with you what is intellectual property as part of your teaching and research activities, what are the aspects related to intellectual property and the rights associated with it, and how to use them in your teaching and research activities at your institutes as you start your career as a professional faculty member there. Okay, so I work at the Industrial Research and Consultancy Center. As Professor Sachin said, it is a coordinating office at IIT Bombay, which handles all the research and development activities, the administration related to the techno administration related to these activities. So let me start and give you a little bit of an overview of what I plan to talk to you today. I am assuming that you know you're all new, you may have some resources, you may already have some practices happening at your institute, or you may not have. So I'm trying to keep it a little basic and informative. This is basically to get you to understand what is intellectual property and why are we talking intellectual property in an academic scenario. So, and then the types of intellectual property. So I'll give you an introduction to the intellectual property and what they are, and also an overview of all the rights associated with it, and then what are the aspects and how we can manage IP in academia. So these are the three kind of pointers that I will discuss with you. The references that I have taken, essentially Google, Wikipedia, I think we will make it available to you, so this information would be there with you. So I won't go into all the various websites and the background that I have used for my presentation. It is a very important information starting here. Whenever you do any kind of a presentation or any kind of a dissemination, when you use any public domain information or any information, it's always important to give reference and acknowledgement to those. Okay, so what is intellectual property? Why are we talking intellectual property? So intellectual property, like any other tangible property, like your car or your home and other assets that you may have, it is a creation of the mind, and so as a result of this creation of a mind, it is accorded a property, and that is why it's called as intangible property, because it's not a tangible asset like your car or a home, but it has similar connotations and similar implications. And this is given a right to the owner, and so there are legal frameworks which come up for giving you the rights and various aspects associated with it. So it refers to the creation of the mind, and it has value and ownership like any tangible property. As I said, like a car or a home or any of those, you also can own what you have created. Now, how do you prove what you have created, etc.? Those are the slides that I'm going to talk further about. And what is, once you have a property, you have to have an ownership, a right accorded to it, a legal aspect, a legal right accorded to it. And that is what is called intellectual property right, IPR. And this is, as I said, legal. And it gives the right to protect the interest of the creator or whoever owns this property that has been created by using the creativity or your, your innovativeness and your thinking. So, just to give you a slide on IP evolution, the property, each of a property has a right. So, when you have intellect and there is a property associated, the right is called IPR. So, if you have an idea which results in an expression, the right associated with that is called copyright. If you have an idea which results in an innovation and an invention, a technical invention, that right is called as a patent right. And then when you have an idea which translates into an appearance, an aesthetic appearance, please don't worry, I will talk a little bit more about the all of them in detail later. This is just to give you an evolutionary slide. The appearance of whatever you have, you've given a creative aspect to an appearance of a product, that has got a right called the design right. And when you take care of, you put in efforts to create a quality and you want to have an identity associated with such a quality, that has got something, a right called the trademark, right? And if you have some idea you want to keep confidential, you don't want to disclose it and you want to keep it proprietary and owned by yourself through a secret, the right considered there is trade secrets. So, why protect? Why called IP? Why do you want to have a property associated with creativity and why do you want to have protection? See, the thing is, it is a reward system. Just the way if you own a house, you can use it, you can stay in it, you can sell it, you can gift it, you can rent it out to someone and you derive value out of it. So, the same way when you have a property, it's a reward system by the law, the legal framework saying that you have created it, you have generated it, so you own it and as a result, you can have certain monopolies and certain benefits arising out of it. And in the system of economy and the knowledge, global knowledge economy, etc., it encourages innovation because all of them have a framework of how the there's a legal framework of what you can own, for how long, which jurisdiction, etc. And after a certain while, after the ownership is given, a monopoly is given, it becomes public domain. And as a result, it also allows others to know what you're doing and it encourages further innovation in that direction. And it avoids reinventing the wheel because if somebody has already generated some innovation and it is available and it's already being practiced, why would you like to get into research doing the same thing again? So there is publications, you can look at journals, you can look at literature, but the statistics say that more than 80% of knowledge is covered in patent literature. That means 80% of what is available in the public or the activities that are happening in every institute and in the public thing is covered in patents and they are patented. So the non-patent literature that you look at through all your websites and things like that, all the various publications don't cover much. And that is why you need to know what is covered in the patents so that you don't reinvent, you don't start your research on an already known or developed topic. So that is one of the reasons for this, protection. And there is a global competitiveness. So obviously, when you are doing, there are industries who want to work in the same area. If you have protection, if you have developed something new and you have gotten protection for that, you obviously get better benefits, you get a, competitiveness and your value increases and your economic benefits go up. And again, so if you have patents, if you have various IPRs as part of your, say, company portfolio or your academic portfolio, that allows incentives for investment. So, the people who look at it and then come to you and pay, you know, give you money, give you funding, etc. to carry out research in this direction. So, this is all sounds very commercial and more so maybe for the companies and, you know, industries, but why in academia? Why do we get very, you know, worked up saying that intellectual property is very important in academia? It's because, see, the IP in academia's basically mandate is to train skilled manpower and take up relevant research and development. In this process, you create scientific knowledge, ideas, innovations, etc. And it's important to reach these research outputs to the public, because that is something you don't want to stop today's, in today's generation, you don't want to just do teaching and, you know, leave at that. Every institute, especially engineering institutes, the mandate is to get into research and teaching and research and development, so that you generate, you innovate, so that you can file patents and your position as an academic institution of repute goes up. And that, as I said, all the various benefits also come into play. So, you have to capitalize the intellectual creativity and assets that are generated in your organization. See, education and research is expensive. So, it's not very simple if I say, you know, okay, innovation leads to you and you suddenly go to your lab and start innovating and generate some new product. It is not so easy. You need funding. You need equipment. You need manpower. You need resources. All these need money. The educational institutions may not have that kind of money to give every, you know, faculty or individual faculty teams. So, for that, you have to generate resources. If you have IP, there are mechanisms by which you can monetize, you can attract funding from industries and other organizations so that it can help you and aid you in your research and development work. And so, you need to have greater interaction with industry to take up meaningful R&D. So, in what are the kind of IP protection related aspects in academia? It provides incentives to researchers. As I said, owning a patent or being an inventor in a patent has a very value added, you know, it's a very value added activity. And the legal framework provides monopoly to the creator and the owner. It allows beneficial linkages with industry, and it recognizes the creator and the university to attract research funding, as I told you. And it also promotes entrepreneurship. Today, with all the Startup India, Make in India, etc. initiatives that the government is promoting, if you generate something of value, you can start your own company, basically through the framework of your universities or your institutions. But there are mechanisms by which this will allow you to start companies and then take your products or your innovation for further commercialization. So, with a brief overview, let me talk, give you more information about what are the kinds of intellectual property rights and what are the various issues like the legal frameworks and other aspects associated with it. This may be something very new or something you would have done it during your academic. There are in IIT Bombay, in fact, we encourage all our students to get involved in meaningful research and generate IP as early as possible. And many of the patents that we file, being an engineering education institution, we do file patents and various other IPRs, but patents are more often the ones we file. And many of these patents have students as young as the undergrad students also are, who are inventors. So, they, this faculty, the M.Tech, PhDs, all of them who have contributed to an invention become inventors in such patents. So, intellectual property is broadly split into industrial property and artistic or creative work, which is covered, this is covered by copyright. And the industrial property are protected by various rights, as I told you, patents, designs, trademarks, geographical indications, I'll talk to you a little bit about that, trademarks, then there's new plant varieties and layout design of semiconductors for IC. So, each, as I said, the legal framework for each of the intellectual property, be they are specific to each of them, but broadly they have a criteria for protection, what, how you can get these rights for each of those IPs. There is a period of validity for how long this protection or the ownership would be valid. There are geographical limits in which these protection or these rights can be exercised. You cannot have what they call a global patent. You can have a patent in India, you can have a patent in the US. So, you have geographical limits within which you can have monopoly to your inventions. And then there are various enforcement features. Each of those would have separate features associated with them. And each of these would have mechanisms which will allow you to license or transfer, just the way you can rent your home or you can sell your home. Essentially, the same way you can license it, or you can even sell or assign the rights to for a certain monetary value or for a certain agreed to terms. And there are various other legal implications to each of them. So, just to give you some information, there is a World Trade Organization at the international level. It was set up in 1977. This is a governing body for trade related aspects of IPR, and various allied agreements are framed by them. They prescribe rules for trade and investment in ideas and creativity. And then there is this WIPO, World Intellectual Property Organization, set up in Geneva, which promotes protection and recognition of IP worldwide. These are all at the international level. It administers 23 international treaties related to IP and seeks to harmonize national IP legislation and procedures, and also provides services for applications for IPR. So, to give you an idea about the legal framework, as I said, you know, the first few things were saying IP, IPR, etc. But what does it mean? How do they get all this rights and the monopoly accorded? So, for copyright, there is a Copyright Act of 1957, which was amended. So, the provisions in this act, the rules in this act apply to all the aspects related to getting a copyright on your creative ideas or expressions. Then for designs, there is a Design Act 2000 and amended rules in 2008. These are the acts, this act gives you all the provisions related to design protection. Geographical indications, again it's of goods and GI of goods Act 1999, and then IT is the IT Act 2000. Then just to continue, for patents, it's a Patent Act 1970, which was amended in 2005, and then the rules, and there's an amended rules in 2006. Then for plant protection, the Plant Varieties Protection and Farmers Right Act, and the Semiconductor and IC also, there is a act associated with them. The trademark is the Trademark Act of 1999 with the rules framed in 2002. So, these are the Indian framework, legal framework, which are associated for the IPRs. So, let me start with giving you information about patents initially. As I said, this would be something which would be more often than not used, or more often than not sought protection for in an engineering institution or in a technical institution, because the innovations and inventions would be capable of being protected under this right. So, what is a patent? Patent is an exclusive right granted by the government to the creator or owner to own and use an invention for a specific period in a specific jurisdiction. Now, this right is given for an innovative product or process which fulfills the following criteria. It has to be novel. It has to be non-obvious. That means there has to be an inventive step, and it has to be of use. It has to have an industrial application. These are the three criteria which has to be fulfilled by any innovative activity that you do. So, suppose you create something, and as I said, you know, you go search the literature and you find that it's already been done by somebody. Then it does not meet the novelty criteria. The novelty criteria means essentially it should be new. It should not have been done anywhere. There are mechanisms of finding out and proving whether it's new or not so. And what is this non-obviousness? Non-obviousness is a subjective aspect, saying how inventive, is there an inventive step in your innovation? It should not be something that, you know, I could have, once you tell me, it's very easy for me to say, oh yes, this is a very simple mechanism. So, there is no inventiveness. I'll give you some examples which will prove, you know, what I mean. Utility, of course, it should have some kind of an application. So, take these examples, you know, the various, let me give you an example of the pin. I always like to talk about the safety pin. Essentially, if you see the safety pin, if you open it up, it's only a piece of wire. It's basically a long piece of steel wire. Now, the steel wire is known, it is nothing novel, nothing great, nothing to be worried about to own, because it's something available everywhere. It's a public matter. Now, there is an inventor who was trying to find some mechanism of trying to pin something up or trying to hold something together. And he was using various contraption and trying to see how he can do it. In the process, he ended up, and I think the story goes that he owed some loan to one of his somebody, and he was wondering how to do that. And while thinking about it, he was twisting a piece of wire, and he managed to twist it in such a way that it could hold, these two ends could be held together, and this helped hold a lot of materials in different forms. So this is the innovation. It's not any disruptive or something new or something completely unknown. It's a piece of wire which has been twisted in an innovative way to create something which has a utility value, which is innovative, it is inventive. So nobody has really, none of us could have thought of it at the first instance. Now that we see it, it is very common thing, it is nothing very new. But at that time, it was an inventive step was seen, and as a result, this has been accorded a patent grant, and it has made a lot of money for the person. Of course, for a certain period, and after that it is a public information, anybody can use it and anybody can improve on it and do anything further to that. So the same way, if you take Velcro, now the story goes that there was a Swiss farmer who was climbing with his dog up the slopes of Switzerland, and the dog had lots of seeds stuck on its fur. So when he came back home and he examined the seed, he found very, very small hooks on the seed which were catching on to the fur of the dog. And so he tried to think of how this can be useful, and then he went on to create the Velcro. Essentially, if you see, there are some hooks and there is the fur. Between the two, you end up getting this Velcro, which is used, in as kind of complicated places as space and everywhere possible. You know, we don't need to know how Velcro is used today. So this is a kind of, things that I want to say. And take this clip. Again, this is a small piece of wire, and if you twist it and you just turn it in a slightly, innovative way, that has a tremendous amount of utility, and it has a value that can be associated with the inventor who has developed this. So he could claim monopoly, he could file a patent, he could derive money out of it, and that is something, it's gone on to, come into play, and so many variations and adaptations have happened further to that. Again, some more, the post-it pad, the zip, and take the barbed wire. Here again, it's a piece of wire, but twisted in such a form that it has sharp ends, which prevents animals from grazing. So the ranches in US had this problem of cattle coming into their ranches, and as a result, they came out with some innovation, which allowed them to patent the barbed wire that is shown here. And various contraption, all these carpenter tools, various kind of tools, all these are, if they have innovative, if they have a value, as they fulfill those criteria, they are capable of being given a protection called the patent right. So, what are the rights conferred by patents? To make, sell, or use the process or product obtained by that process, and to exclude others from using. So, it is granted to an applicant. He can be the true or the first inventor, or it can be the organization or entity to whom the invention is assigned to. And the owner can give a license or transfer it to the others to work the invention and commercialize through appropriate agreements. So, just to give you an example, IIT Bombay, it has an IP policy. And as per the policy, all inventions, innovations, R&D outputs that are generated by faculty, student and staff is owned by the institute. So, when this happens, the inventor is, and say, IITB employee, but the owner is IIT Bombay, and any kind of licensing that happens will happen by IIT Bombay to the company interested or the licensee who will be able to commercialize, and whatever money or whatever agreements are put in place to generate revenues or royalties are shared back with the inventors as per the policy. So, I'll talk about the policy, how you should put up frameworks in a, in an academic institution. But just to give you an idea, what does this mean, the inventor or an applicant? It can be either. If you start a company with the innovation that you have made, you can be the owner, you can be the applicant, you can also be the inventor. So, that law allows you to be that. So, all kinds of possibilities are there based on the policies that are available. So, I'm trying to focus mainly on academic institutions, because that is what we are, and that is what we want to think of and then try to put into practice. Okay, so what are the further rights? So, in case anybody is infringing or anybody is copying your work, when you have already claimed monopoly and you have been granted, then you can initiate legal proceedings against infringement and unauthorized use. So, as we said, it allows you to exclude others from using it, what you have generated. So, the law allows you to also initiate legal proceedings. The term of the protection is 20 years from the date of filing. And the jurisdiction, as I said, is territorial, which means you have to protect in specific countries designed for exclusivity. So, let us say you create some innovation which is very specific to the Indian market. It does not have value to the US or some of the developed nations, for example. It is something of use to the developing countries. So, you may want to say when you go for filing and you know you go for a claiming protection, you can say I want only the Indian. Because you just go and get the protection in India, you don't need to worry about the US or any other foreign countries. However, let's say you have generated something which has a global presence, which has a global sort of, you know, use. Then you may have to strategize and decide, okay, I'll file in India, I'll file in the US. I'm not sure whether I want to go to Japan or not, but I will go to Australia. So, all these kind of decisions, but everywhere you have to file a separate request for protection because it is territorial. There is nothing called a global patent or a worldwide patent. Okay? This is in respect of patents. So, just to give you an example, in 1845, the lock stitch machine was the most basic level of a sewing machine which they generated, which was accorded a patent. And once this became public information after 20 years, others took this on, used it, upgraded it, developed it further, and today, you know, in 2008, you can see something called a brother serger machine, which is highly complicated and take on so many kinds of complicated sewing and, you know, cloth, textile related activities. So, essentially, it's just to show how you can grow, how you can move ahead and create and upgrade knowledge information based on the patent monopoly that you have for a certain period of time. So, okay, so if I say inventions have to meet these three criteria, then obviously they might also, the rules, I am just trying to give you a broad overview or the relevant aspects of the act, you know, which are important to keep in mind. So, if it says that patents can be given to a process or a product which fulfill the criteria, there are also provisions which say that certain things are not patentable. So, you can't say suddenly, you know, okay, I know how to pick a lock. I will go and patent my product, it's a very innovative product, and go sell it to somebody who's ready to pick locks in homes. So, you know, it's something like that. So, that is something immoral, or that is something which is not towards the human sort of safety and well-being. So, such kind of things, even though they may fulfill those three criteria, they are not patentable. So, like that, there are certain things which are not patentable. For example, frivolous inventions which are contrary to natural laws, these are not patentable. And so, use of any product or process which is contrary to public order, morality, or causes harm, that is also not patentable. For example, take a gambling machine. You do have gambling machines, you do have people going to all these places, but those are not patentable because that is not something the government feels it's important to patent. Discovery of a scientific principle, living or a non-living substance in nature, or a new form of a known substance, or a new property. For example, aspirin is used for headaches, but it also has a role to play in heart-related disease. So, these kinds of, you may say, oh, that's something I have discovered or I have researched and I got this information, I should be able to claim a patent on it. Those are not possible to patent. So, they are very clearly guidelines given on what is patentable and what is not patentable. A method of agriculture or horticulture, processes for medical and diagnostic treatments, mathematical and business methods, none of these are patentable. And sometimes they'll say, oh, I have a machine which is more than 100% efficient. Now, that is not something which is possible. So, you know, this kind of frivolous inventions are not possible to get patent protection. So, to give you an idea about what the patent protection process is, you have to submit an application with what is called as a provisional or a complete specification which fulfills all those criteria. So, a provisional and a complete, the difference between this is, suppose you have done an invention or you have done some research which is very, very basic level or very early level, you know, you have just done a proof of concept and you have done some kind of a crude model of a prototype or a benchtop model of a particular product. And you know that it is new, it's novel, nobody has thought of it, but it needs some more refinement, some more ideas to actually put it into practice and make it reproducible. So you can go, but you want to claim priority because you want to either publish or you're going to talk about it somewhere. So you can go and file what is called a provisional patent application. When I say you can go, all these are done at the Indian Patent Office. So you can go and file there, and then later on within a year, you can complete your work and then file what is called a complete specification or a complete application, putting all the claims. You have to claim what you're going to protect. Put all of them and then submit a patent application. There are global agreements which allow processes for seeking protection over worldwide. These are all details. Once you get into this, you will have lot more information available everywhere. How to file, where to file, how to do it jurisdiction wise, etc. You can always find a lot of information in the in that patent office site also where I've given. Prior art search. Now, why I want to talk about prior art search? This is something which is useful to decide whether your work is novel or not. So, as I said, novelty is one of the criteria, and prior art search allows you to search the literature, both freely available public domain information, freely available and also through paid databases, to see whether your work that you have done is actually new or already done by someone else. So, there are various sites, various mechanisms, various databases. Some of them are free, some of them are purchased. You have to buy them. You have to sort of install and buy these on license mode, and then you can see whether your work is novel or not. This is just to give you an overview of the patent process in India, and you can read this at your leisure, what all are all the procedural matters that have to be taken care of. This is just an example of an Indian patent granted. This is a certificate which is very important, which you should have for your product, and it allows you to own this thing for a period of 20 years. And this is the front cover of that, and then this is the US patent, just a sample of a US patent grant certificate. And these are all, see, the certificate issued, and these are all published in the official journal. So when you have the Indian patent office, all the patented technologies, everything is published. So what is patent? You disclose your invention to the government to get a monopoly. Now, this disclosure means it has to be available to the public to be able to practice it through a license from you. Unless they know you own it, they will not be able to come to you to say, ma'am or sir, can I get a license to it? How will they know you own it? It is published in the patent office website. It is available for anybody to see who owns what kind of technology which they may be interested in, so that they can approach us for a license or a purchase or whatever is the need of for that particular entity. So that is why it is published in the official journal of the patent office. So what are the due diligence you should take from the point of view of an academician or a faculty or team where you're, you know, going to supervise students and conduct research and development at your end? You should see that your research outputs satisfy the legislative criteria. That means you should conduct the prior art search very carefully, and you should see what is the problem being researched and the unique features that are coming out of your solution. It can be incremental. It need not be disruptive. It need not be a completely new technology. It can be some small kind of a growing, you know, something additional, but which basically fulfills the inventive step. Then that will help you get an ownership of that particular innovation. And what are the advantages or improvements over existing methods, device, knowledge? So that's what I said. It can be incremental over these as long as it's seen as inventive. Economic and commercial applications of the technology to fulfill the third criteria. And also, what aspect of the invention needs protection? Essentially, you know, if you have generated something, you don't want to go and claim something which you have not done. You have to see carefully what you have done which you need to claim protection on. So, it's very important. I mean, it may sound a little hazy today, but for the lack of time, I'm not able to go very deep into these. Just trying to give you pointers so that when you get into this mode of trying to, you know, understand what is my work, whether it's got a value, whether it's got any innovativeness, then all these aspects will come into play. And you should keep all this in mind while working on your ideas and your innovative, aspects work. And as I said, you have to give a full disclosure. So, that's why your writing and your specification should be very carefully drafted. Okay. So, about copyright. This is an exclusive right given by law for a certain term, to authors to have their authorship in creative works acknowledged and protected. So this is the symbol. When you have a, you know, write up or you have a paper or anything, you can own it by putting the symbol copyright. And these have two types of rights. One is economic rights and one is the moral rights. So what does it protect? It protects the form of expression. Not that, you know, I have an idea, I have a story, etc. But that story has to be put on paper. And the way you have written it, the way you have articulated your idea or you have expressed your idea in a creative manner, that is what is accorded, what is called as a copyright. Paper articles, books, paintings, media presentation, music, lyrics, films, computer programs, etc. What are these? The economic rights gives you various rights, a bundle of rights. The moral rights basically allows you to say that, look, I am the owner, I am the author. Even if you have sold your rights, you can still say that the moral rights allows you to say, I am the author or I am the creator of that copyright. And nobody has a right to distort it or bring disrepute to yourself. So that is the moral right that is also accorded by the law to the author, even though they may transfer or assign their rights. So it is a bundle of rights. It allows you to take care of it, reproduce, adapt, broadcast, record, translate, etc. So various rights are given as part of this IP right. And there is no typical international copyright protection, but because of various laws are amalgamated together, a similar kind of copyright exists across various countries. And also protection to foreign works are based on international treaties and conventions. So this is all covered by the Berne Convention. What is the term of a copyright for various types of creative works? For literary, dramatic, musical and artistic work, it's 60 years after the death of the author. For cinematograph, films, sound recordings, photographs, publications, posthumous publications, work of government, etc. is 60 years from the date of publications. So, copyright gives you various rights, but there are also exceptions and fair use which allows academics to use all these copyrighted material. Otherwise, how would you use all the various journals, etc. that you look for, and you use some of those information? You might give them reference, you might pull some information from them to include in your publication, etc. So these are, and also you might use them for your teaching. When you're teaching a class, you will like to refer to some of the already published information. That's all copyrighted. But that for academic teaching purposes, these fair use provisions are there, which allows you to use copyrighted information. Some examples, as I said, literary, dramatic, cinematograph work, music, photography, computer software, graphic drawing and sculpture, animations and videos, architectural works, etc. So, just to give you some graphics, you have Finding Nemo, the film, the Mickey Mouse, and then this is a software developed at IIT Bombay, Gram++, which has been accorded a copyright protection, and then all these journals, the articles in these journals, the books like Harry Potter. There's in fact a Mumbai Rail map again developed and, you know, generated at IIT Bombay, which has been protected by a copyright registration. So just to give you an idea, you know, you don't need to have always just these kind of commercial things that you look at, but you can also do lots of things in-house in your academic institutions, which will allow you to get a copyright. You know, you can generate software, you will be developing software. A software can be accorded a copyright. The same way you might have written a book. The book would allow you to own a copyright on that book. So, there are various ways in the academic institutions which can get this right. So, there is just a right called the Creative Commons. It's a slightly diluted right of a copyright. This is used mainly by academic institutions and people who want to disseminate it to the public at large. So, it's a weaker right. It's a public license that enables free distribution of an otherwise copyrighted work. So, for example, every article, every creative work can be copyrighted, but if you feel you don't want to own it, you want to just disseminate it in the public, you can use it under Creative Commons, or you can disseminate it under Creative Commons license. So, this is allowed. Just to give you an information, like we at IIT Bombay, the talk to the teacher activity of the National Mission on Education and ICT has been protect, not protected, has been given a Creative Commons license. So, anybody can use it either with acknowledgement or without acknowledgement. There are various provisions under this which allows you to use it accordingly. And also there is a ChemPlay, which is a kit to teach concepts in chemistry. This also we have released it under the Creative Commons license to the public. So, I am just giving you examples of what has done it, been done at IIT Bombay. So, it gives you a reference on how you can also use them from the from your academic institutions and your activity in there. Designs. So, what is design, right? It is given to a creative activity related to an ornamental or an aesthetic appearance of an article. Please note that this is different from the technical aspect in a patent. In a patent, you have to have a technical aspect, whereas here it is mainly creative or the aesthetic. So, for example, if you take a chair, the chair by virtue of how it is useful to seat somebody and gets a technical aspect on it can be protected as a patent. It has happened and it is already out, but it can be protected as a patent. However, the shape of the chair, you know, the way it is shaped, with you may have arms, you may not have arms, all those aspects, the aesthetic look of a chair is accorded what is called as a design right. So, for example, the way books are stacked in a shelf, this is called a, got a design right. Very close to home, the post box, the way it is, you know, there is a steel post box with a way that, you know, the letters can be put in, all these kind of the aesthetic look at, developed at IIT Bombay's IDC Industrial Design Center has been accorded a design right. Shape of a scooter, shape of your Crocs, immediately you can relate, oh, this is a Crocs shoe because the way it is put and the way shape and etc. very typical of a particular brand. And the watch, all these are accorded what is called as design right. Then comes trademark. As I said, this is for the origin, the signs or which are capable of distinguishing goods or services from one undertaking from those of the other. And this can be accorded to a logo, name, slogan, symbol, shape, color, sound, etc. McDonald's, for example, your Kit Kat, the MasterCard, just the color is the trademark which is given, because just by virtue of this orange and yellow, you can make out it's a MasterCard. And the Tata, the symbol, Benz, closer home again, the Tech Fest, which is a very famous student cultural fest, has been accorded, a technical fest, sorry, has been given a trademark. IIT Bombay files a lot of trademark for various activities that we do. And Skype, for example. So, all these are examples of what, how you can protect through a trademark registration. And these again have all those, you know, jurisdictions, the territorial rights, the what do you say, the validity period, etc., and various other legal frameworks. I'm not getting too detailed into that because these are all available as information that you can read in any of the public literature. Geographical indication. This will be of interest just to show that what is this particular right, which is more of a recent phenomena. It essentially identifies agricultural, natural or manufactured goods originating from a definite territory. So, you would hear champagne, for example, is one of the famous things which have been accorded a geographical indication, because it has a certain quality and a value and it is coming from a particular region of France. And that is why it is given what is called a GI right, geographical indication right. Again, the Tirupati laddus, Basmati, then Kulu shawls, your Agra Petha, Jaipur pottery, all Kolhapur chappals, all these are very specific. Immediately you know that Kolhapur chappals, okay, it's very famous. It comes from Kolhapur. You find it everywhere. That's a different matter. But the Kolhapur chappals have a specific way of being made, a specific source, a specific material. And once all that is documented and submitted, they are given a specific right called that geographical indication right. And if you want to say you are a company or institution, you just giving as an example, you want to market such chappals and call them Kolhapuri chappals, you have to get a license from those people who own the GI. So, that is what I mean by saying what the ownership can help you in. So, again, IPR doesn't mean you have to do only a patent or a design or a trademark. Your product, your work can have various baskets of rights associated with the same work or the same product or process. For example, taking Coca-Cola, the name Coca-Cola enjoys a copyright. The way it is written, because it's an artistic work, it enjoys a copyright. the Coca-Cola can, the can opening mechanism that you see here, that is a technical intervention and that has a patent right associated with it. Okay, and then you have this again, this is a at the trademark Coca-Cola, the way it is written, it is a trademark because this can immediately tell you that where it comes from, what is the company, what is the origin of the goods, and so it also enjoys a trademark. And the shape of the bottle, again, even if you didn't see the Coke, the shape of the bottle is very distinct and that shape is also accorded a trademark. So, you can see that there are lots of rights associated with the same activity. Of course, and the Coke inside, the drink itself is actually protected by trade secret. It is not given any right because India doesn't have trade secrets, right? The trade secrets are more in the US, etc. They are basically given to confidential information which you want to keep protected and you have means and mechanisms of proving that you have kept them protected. So, all the rights are actually applied here in a for this Coca-Cola. Similarly, you can take a camera, you can have a camera, the name is got a trademark, Nikon camera, the inside mechanisms can be patented, the shape of the camera can have a design right. So, you know, and the logo, of course, the name has got a logo, the logo can have a trademark. So, various types of rights are associated with such things. And mind you, even in our institute like IIT Bombay and academic institutions, we have cases where we have at least 3-4 rights associated with a particular product or a product, and that has been licensed to companies or startups to commercialize them. So, here also we can do it. It is not that it always has to be a Coke or a Nikon kind of a entity. So, this is to give you a brief overview about IP. As I said, you can read a lot more about it depending on how interested you are, and I would request you to read up whenever you are starting research, whenever, even in your academic teaching, you will have lot of copyright issues that you need to keep in mind. So, please do be aware of intellectual property, its do's and don'ts, its values, the need to be aware of it in all your teaching and research activity. So, after this, I want to just talk about intellectual property management in an academic institution. I will focus mainly keeping in mind what we do at IIT Bombay. We are very happy to talk to you, answer questions whenever you need any help, inputs. Please ask us. We are more than happy to share the practices, the procedures, the processes, the policies that we have in our institute. We would like to put across as a generic statement of how academic institutes should manage intellectual property, because intellectual property is something you would generate on a daily basis in all your activities, and so it's important to manage that also effectively. Why do you need IP management? Why IP? Now, why do you need IP management? Because the role of IP becomes important during academic activities. Like as I said, teaching and research, if you are going to, you know, take lectures using somebody's copyrighted information, then you have to keep that in mind. If you want to take, you know, some specific go give lectures, how do you do that? And when you are taking information from either no public domain or otherwise, how you have to keep all the, you know, how have to use these things properly, you have to keep in mind. Same way, you know, you might be guiding MTechs, BTechs, BEs, etc. What all are the issues that need to be kept in mind while doing literature search? All those things you have to keep in mind while doing research and teaching. And also outreach activities, like IIT Bombay offers a lot of continuing education programs to various institutes, government bodies, industries, etc. So, IP issues do come up in picture, and that is why we have to be careful about it. And then we do lot of R&D collaboration with industries and organizations. So, IP becomes very important, because what IP do you have, what IP do they have, what IP are we going to generate together or individual, how do we handle all that. So, agreements are important to be in place to address all these aspects. And then when you do a license or transfer to an industry and entrepreneurship, everywhere you will see that IP becomes an important matter to be addressed and documented appropriately. And that is why you definitely need to have a mechanism for managing IP generated and used in your institutes. So, you want to derive maximum benefits from IP and its use. So, what do? You have to assess the innovation. Please note all that I have said there. The one thing I have not talked about at all is the financial aspects. When you talk about legal, you want to register your home, you know how much it would cost you, all the stamp duties and various registration procedures. The same way, when you go to file a patent application, basically you go to seek protection for your intellectual property. it costs money. The money is essentially in two ways. One is the government fees. For filing an application, they will charge you some fee. For doing some examination, what they call an understanding, what your patent or what your IP is about, whether it's following those criteria, whether there are some objections, all that will entail government fee. More than the government fee, it will entail what is called the attorney fees. Because we are technical, so we don't have all knowledge about how to file the patent, and it's a techno-legal activity. You are technical people, but the legal people are the ones who will be able to help you do these activities. Typically and almost always, you have to go through an attorney, what they call as a patent attorney or an IP attorney. When you go through them, obviously, professional fees are quite high. So, you have to keep in mind, it's not a simple or a easy or a cheap procedure. So, you have to strategize. Do I want to just give away everything in the public domain because I don't have money to file a patent? Or if I file a patent, does it have a good licensing potential to reach a commercial entity and then I can monetize it? So, it will be good for me to go file a patent and incur some expenditure. And this you have to do at the individual level, at your institute level. The policies that would be put in place would enable you to look at all these aspects. So, that is why I said that innovation assessment is very important. Do you want to file a patent? Do you want to file a copyright? Do you want to file a design or do you want to file a trademark? What is important? What is it that you have done? Have you done a technical intervention or you have designed a creative sort of a, you know, design for a product? So, what is it? So, you have to first assess that and then you have to seek the appropriate protection. You don't want to, file a patent for a design that you created. They will say, sorry, it's not possible. So, that you have to assess and you have to see what is to be done. And as I said, it's legal and it's expensive. So, you have to generate strategies. Should I file now? Should I file a provisional? And if I'm not doing well, I give it up. Or I know that provisional I'll file so that and immediately I find a licensee. So, that as I'm doing better and gaining more information and setting up my claims, I find somebody to take it further. Same way you file in India and you see, is there some potential in the US? Is there someone who can take it and use it for in the US? So, then let me see if I can file a US application or not. Various decisions you'll have to take based on all these aspects that you need to keep in mind. So, you have to see the commercializations, you know, what are the potential for commercializations. And also, of course, in an institutional manner, one has to also see that if the institution owns it, it has to incentivize the innovators. Otherwise, what is the motivation? Like you go, you know, you do something interesting and the institute says, okay, you have nothing to do, you know, so thank you very much. And they walk off with that patent or that application. There's nothing left for you. Then you have to be able to get motivated and even motivate your students. So, that is why an institutional framework is needed for this IP management. Processes are needed for that creation, protection, utilization, deployment, awareness and incentivizing researchers. At the institutional level, it would be good if whoever is interested, get back to your institutes and see that you are able to motivate them to set up policies which will allow all the people to benefit accordingly. What are the activities pertaining within this IP management? Formulation of an institute policy. This is very important because this will allow you to work within the framework of the policy. One should put up process and support for IP protection and also give some legal support for various agreements, contracts and also for filing. You know, filing activities needs to be done through legal support. Then you look at technology commercialization, what are the prospects and put provisions, framework of processes for technology commercialization and what kind of incentives and recognition that you want to give the inventors and innovators. And in all these also create awareness programs and mechanisms to reach out to the maximum to get sensitized to this regime of IP. So, what kind of IP policy you can have as a framework? You should have a vision and mission statement. And then you define ownership of IP, who owns it, under what circumstances and what are the exceptions. For example, as giving an example from IIT Bombay, the copyright policy. IIT says that all the copyright which subsists in a thesis of a student, M.Tech and a PhD student, is owned by the student and the guide. The institute does not claim ownership. However, if a PhD thesis has a software which is developed, as part of the work there is a software developed, that software is an IP owned by the institute. Even though it may have a copyright, but that copyright is owned by the institute. The IP policy essentially allows you to set a framework on who owns it, what are the exceptions, and as I said, all the various provisions should be covered there. What kind of, who will own, what will be the provisions for technology licensing, what will be the provisions for processes for protection. It may say that, the institute will take up all the protection and they will want to review your invention. Suppose you say you go to the institute authorities and say, I have developed so and so, my team has developed so and so, we feel it might be possible to file a patent application. They may say, no, have you done this, have you done a prior art search? No, we'll put up a committee to see that, this is possible, this is worth patenting. You define ownership and exceptions, should have a unit, a coordinating unit. This is where, as we said, IRCC is the coordinating unit at IIT Bombay, which handles IP management. It would be good to have a coordinating unit for all the administrative work, should have a process for disclosure of inventions, review and assessment of innovations, because not every invention innovation can become patent or can be filed. So, you have to have a mechanism, and then you have to look at all the filings, as I said, through legal attorneys. You have to hire attorneys or have a panel or someone who can help you in this, and then you have to have someone who can help on all the contracts and agreements. Also, look at technology commercialization aspects, these should be covered, and the revenue sharing. Again, as an example from IIT Bombay, whatever IIT owns all the IP and it files, it protects and takes up all the costs, at least in India, the initial instance. And if it commercializes through licensing and revenues are received either as a one-time fee or as a royalty, 70% of those revenues are shared with the inventors. So, this is one of the most generous policies where we say that we would like to incentivize the researchers by giving 70% of whatever we get back to them. And that also we have mechanisms either by equal sharing, or what if they agree to some other mechanism of sharing, we are okay with that, if as long as all the inventors have agreed. And this is how we work our IP, filings and commercializations and revenues received from there. So, what are the processes and support one can offer? Encourage and facilitate disclosure of innovations. We allow self-assessment by offering paid prior art search mechanisms. So, a faculty or a student can come and do prior art search in our office and then say that, yes, we feel it is novel, and we provide this prior art search facility. We have a panel of attorneys who will help us for all the IP filings. We try to seek early protection, typically if you want to submit a paper for publication or you want to present your work at a conference, because patent, the novelty will be lost if you make a presentation and then file for protection. So, we go and file a provisional almost overnight or over 2-3 days itself, so that then you can go to the conference and make your work public. Because once you file for protection, the protection is accorded, even though it may happen a little later based on examination, but the protection is accorded from the date of filing the application. So, we also, as I said, pre-publication draft, somebody is writing a publication and submitting it to a journal, we ask them to submit it to us so that we can review if it is possible to file a protection and claim a patent, out of it. And we take up the cost for patent protection, IP protection. And also, when there are students, the master students who submit thesis every year to the institute tries to look at the thesis proactively to see if some innovative work has been covered, which the team might have overlooked for filing of a patent or an IP. We try to sensitize them, go back to them, talk to them. And in this case, in this way, we have seen that at least a few more patents have resulted out of the work which would have otherwise gone into just public domain. For technology commercialization, so we provide legal support. When I say we, it's I'm just giving you an idea of what IIT Bombay does. We provide support for agreements and various types of MOUs, and also put in various efforts for commercialization of the IP, which is generated and owned by the institute. We license it to the companies, various companies, or we do collaborative R&D with the industries and transfer it. Also, we promote entrepreneurship by allowing students, staff and faculty to start companies through our incubation mechanism that we have in place, and also license the IP to them under very beneficial terms. And one of the ways of disseminating our information is important, so that we can attract more licensing. We do lot of dissemination through various fora, like brochures, flyers, booklets, exhibitions. At various fora we try to, and websites, we have a portal by which people can write to us or tell us what they are interested in. We showcase all our innovations in our website. This way we try to see if we can increase our licensing activity. and like I said, advertisements, brochures, websites, etc. And incentives. So we give lot of, we try to make sure that people are happy filing a patent, and before that generating meaningful R&D. We share the revenues from technology licensing. We promote entrepreneurship through simple models. We disseminate success stories and provide awards for technology development efforts. Also give support to student-led innovation efforts by giving funding to them, mentorship, etc. We provide a lot of support in those areas. And also we give a lot of effort for awareness by having IPR and entrepreneurship courses for students. We conduct workshops, seminars, IP clinics, and various continuous interaction and dissemination are made available to the staff of the faculty, student and staff of the institute. So as a concluding remark, I think it's very important to understand the implications of IP in an academic scenario and the rights associated with it. You should have a balance in education, research and translation efforts. Also see that one encourages and facilitates and promote and collaborate for meaningful R&D. So from the beginning, as you're entering the new professional career of being a faculty in your institution, please keep in mind that you should try and see, along with your teaching, should take up research with your team, a team of students, and also keep all this in mind while you're doing, so that you can bring in some meaningful research outputs coming out of your work. Thank you. If you have any questions, I'll be more than happy to answer. I know some of this is run through very quickly, but there's a lot of information available, and if you have anything specific, please ask us. My information is available on the site, and any questions, we'll be more than happy to answer. Yes. What is the cost of the patent? Okay. So, as I told you, he is asking what is the cost of filing a patent and how to approach. Okay, his question is, when he has filed a patent and he does a little bit more work, can he continue into a new patent, or how can he go ahead? So, let me explain this a little bit more on the novelty point of view, from that point of view. Suppose you do some innovative work and you file a patent application, and with a process of examination, etc., it gets granted. Now, you are continuing, obviously, this is some research work and you have an area, that's an interest that you have in, and you will continue further work. Now, when you continue further work and you generate some more new knowledge, let's say, or new intellectual property, if that intellectual property fulfills those three criteria, then you can file a new patent. Now, suppose you have generated a know-how and you have just found a new application to the know-how, let's say, that patent. Now, that application cannot be filed as a new patent. Okay, so it will not fulfill the criteria that is needed for a patent. But suppose, based on this old patent, which we can call as background IP, you have created a new intellectual property which can stand on its own, then you can file a new patent. Now, there are lots of other provisions. You can have patent of addition. So, you can have various, patent continuation in parts. So, if you have put some incremental work, that can be as a daughter or a, child patent of the original patent. So, there are various provisions. So, these are all within the legal framework. These all you can have access to. These are things which would be possible when you sit and talk to an attorney, and he would be able to tell you that, look, it doesn't fit into this. So, you can do a continuation in part. You can have a patent of addition. So, I can go through a lecture on all the patent related activities and what are the various types of patents and how you can file them. That is one answer. The cost of the patent is, as I said, typically major cost is involved with the attorney fees. So, on an average, it will be around 1 to 1.2 lakhs for the filing alone, around that much, with the fees. Indian patent I am talking about. Indian patent, it can be cheaper also, but from our point of view, with the attorneys, yes, but now you also have lot of government initiatives like NRDC, TIFAC, DST, etc., they are supporting patenting costs for various institutions, you know, who do not have separate funding or in sufficient funds for filing of patents. They offer their panel of attorneys who are definitely low costs. Okay, they come at slightly economic costs. So you can avail of that. But I am just saying, on an average, it takes almost 2 lakhs plus for a patent to be filed, examined, and then the patent to be kept alive for 20 years, you have to pay renewal fees. And now the patent office costs have increased substantially. Although I do not remember the exact figure, but take for the 14th or 15th year of renewal, it goes up to 40,000 per year renewal. So when you add all that, it almost translates to nearly 3 lakhs or so for a patent to be filed, examined, and renewed for this 20 years time. If your PhD thesis work is something innovative and it fulfills those criteria, routinely our PhD students are filing patents. Your PhD thesis, as I said, is a copyrighted, okay? The thesis is a copyright. But if you have done, obviously you are going to write something on that. Say, suppose you have developed some technical aspect or some product as part of your work, or you have generated some procedure or some process which is innovative, then that process can be filed as a patent application. So that is the thing. So the way of writing is the copyright, but the technical aspect of what you have worked on will be accorded a patent right. You can file a patent application. Any questions, any kind of doubts you have, please do ask. If not now, later, anytime, you know, we are okay. Thank you.